Hey, good afternoon. It's Patrick Lovell coming to you May 31st at 3:26 p.m. my time. And it's been kind of an exciting day for me. I've been on the phone for the course of the last several hours talking to some significant players that will hopefully be in a position to help us move more of the information that we have on our shelves into new projects that will hopefully find their way to very large audiences. And, you know, it's on the heels of actually the intersection, I should say, of a release of an interview that we'll plug a link to that just got released today of my partner and I, Eric Vaughn, being interviewed by a fabulous journalist by the name of Paul Jay. And I just sat through that interview and I was just astounded. We did it some time ago, but his production team put together a really nice presentation of our interview, and you'll get a great sense of who my partner Eric Vaughn is. And, you know, further what we reveal on the con and how it plays out in really what everything is all about at this very moment. And it was great to hear Paul's sort of take on things. And you put that into context with this person whose name I'll remain silent or a secret at the moment. I'm not going to reveal who I was talking to, but a person who's been around for a very long time, a person who understands a lot about the lay of the land, who's been at the highest levels of government, who understands and has been involved with people at the highest levels of entertainment, Hollywood, as well as tech and some other things. And, you know, this guy just gave us really the most ultimate compliment, and it really fused beautifully with what was revealed in this interview with Paul Jay, which is he was incredibly inspired by our commitment and integrity. And that's really what it's all about. Commitment and integrity, because what he was revealing to us was that, I mean, all over the world in the power strata, people are recognizing more and more how corrupt the United States has become. And what I'm desperately trying to get word to the American people of how fucking corrupt we actually are. It's mind-boggling the failure of our media. And I hate to give any credence to Donald Trump. And if you're a Trump supporter out there, I am not saying that I'm a fan of Trump because I say that media has been an absolute disaster. He just knew that from the inside because of all the things he's gotten away with for years and continues to get away with. And so have the rest of them. And there just seems to be this sort of, I'd say, awareness. And I've got an opening, it feels like. People are starting to think, wait a second, this dude Patrick Lovell has been coming at me and telling me things, and I'm listening to different pieces of the puzzle, and now I got to watch this, and then I come to grips with that, and now all of a sudden other people are saying this, and wait a second, why is this cat Patrick Lovell the only dude who's telling it to me straight? I don't know. I honestly don't know. I don't know why the New York Times never put all of this together. I mean, I've got a pretty good sense of it, but I don't have the actual details. It's part cultural. It's part influence from a major Wall Street financial institution that bought into the business platform at the New York Times. And it's also, like I said, cultural. You know, a lot of folks that come out of the New York Times went to Ivy League schools. They have friends that wound up in finance. New York is pretty close community. And quite frankly, the New York Times is owned by a billionaire family, and that billionaire family has a lot of interest in seeing the United States economy do well. It's a huge institution. And of course, a lot of people have retirement funds wrapped up in this system, and it's got to work. Otherwise, they're not going to work. Except the problem is the Fourth Estate's job is to make sure that what we're in the midst of doesn't happen. And so literally, I've read Wall Street Journal articles over the course of the last 10 years that I think have been pretty close to a lot of real significant revelations, as has, quite frankly, a number of other financial institution rags, you know, but the New York Times never got there. I mean, it's gotten bits and pieces of it, but they never put together the full story. And why is that? Like I just said, they've got a reason not to want this to get out because it's going to hurt them. And, you know, any other institution of mainstream media, whether it's CNN, whether it's, you know, Fox, whether it's MSNBC, all of them are part of larger global consortiums that are part of this strata that's based on financing through Wall Street and the sorts of ebbs and flows that have rewarded, quite frankly, the people that are at the heads of those sorts of verticals. And why rock the boat, man? You've got to finance your business. I mean, we need debt. We need finance. There's no question about it. We need police. We need judges. We need the military. Quite frankly, we need oil. All of those things we need. What we don't need is insane corruption. What we need are cops that do the job for the people, that don't sit on their hands and on the sidelines during a freaking tragedy like, you know, what happened in Texas, where they're there for an hour while children are, you know, dialing in a frenzy and a panic, you know, and parents are trying to save their kids, and the cops are preventing the parents from getting them to do their job. Is in its own right, it kind of a, in a nutshell, sort of reflection of what we're talking about. So the cops get to carry the guns because they're the ones who are supposed to do the right thing, not to protect themselves, but to protect the people. And then you have regulation and you have systems baked in from the Department of Justice and the Federal Bureau of Investigations and the Securities and Exchange Commission that their entire purpose is to prevent what it is that I had to reveal to you. And that same goes for the New York Times and the Washington Post and all of the other major media outlets in this country who, A, didn't have the, they didn't have the compunction. They didn't have the commitment. They didn't have the integrity to do the story because, I don't know, it's a combination of a lot of things, but it's mostly, I think, because it would hurt their bottom line and they don't want to rock the boat. And then also, you know, it's because, quite frankly, Americans don't have a whole lot of bandwidth. I used to think it was just insane that I remember hearing, like, long ago, I mean, I'm going to go back to the 70s on this one, that, you know, most newspapers in the country were written to a sixth grade level. And I was like, ah, bullshit. There's no way, man. Americans are a hell of a lot more sophisticated than that. We know what's going on. We're the citizenry. We're supposed to hold power to account. But meanwhile, if the Fourth Estate is basically dumbing it all down because nobody gets the elixir of power, then how are we as citizens going to be able to hold power to account? We're not. Especially in this sort of insane sort of era where, you know, corruption has always existed. You know, the flaws of mankind have always existed. And a lot of what's on display now is stuff that's happened, you know, throughout history. It's just, you know, step and repeat. It's just basically humanity. But what's different is the speed and the scope of how things can happen because of technology. It's a runaway train wreck. And, you know, the thing that I just need you to understand above all, and this is just the basic construction. I could go on for hours to give you the intricacies of the ABCs, of the details, of the policy, and what took place when and how to be able to create this reality. But this is what you need to understand. Since 2009, the Federal Reserve has been both supply and demand. They create 0% interest for the financiers, for the financial apparatuses that create what we show in the con at www.thecon.tv to create hyper-increased, you know, asset values. And instead of the open market purchasing, you know, the product ultimately, which is based on trust, which is based on underwriting, which is based on common sense, based on a predicated of an economy that's actually functioning. All of those things that we, you know, expect, like, for example, you don't know how a plane operates, but you expect it to fly. It's that sort of analogy. And so in the end, what happens is that these financiers, these asset managers, these private equity guys, these big, too big to fail banks, they can package up all of these loans and they can get off their books and they sell it right back to the Federal Reserve, who sells it on the open market in bonds. And that's how they perpetuate this stuff. If you took out quantitative easing over the course of the last 13 years, we wouldn't have the economy that we have. Now, we would have probably had an absolute global disaster, and we probably had a World War III at this time, and maybe half of humanity would have perished. I don't know. I don't know. I think that's a possibility. I think it's a strong possibility. So maybe we just put Band-Aids on the problem, and then ultimately, you know, like Humpty Dumpty, you can't fix it, right? And maybe we're on the verge of that again. All I know is that corruption will persist if you don't understand what's at stake, if you don't understand the details, if you don't understand that you have to come out of your shell. You have to join me in mass. You have to come to the grips with what we've laid out in the con, that the entire apparatus of power, both media and the financialization of this country, as well as the political machinery of it all, which is a duopoly that's owned by the system that I'm revealing to you, has done a lot and maybe gone to great lengths to prevent the con from being seen. I'm not quite sure. You know, I struggle sometimes. I know the acquisition executives, a lot of times the people that are in power, basically fail upwards, and you get like, you know, morons who couldn't tie their shoelaces together about how the world works. And that's why we get a lot of the type of programming we do. But, you know, it, through fiction, we see all the time the real world mechanics, you know, and a lot of the stuff that I've talked about. I mean, whether it's, you know, Game of Thrones from the psychology and the power perspective, or, you know, Peaky Blinders does a hell of a great job about the fusion between corruption and politics, and the era itself, which is a precursor to everything that we're in the midst of. Breaking Bad is one of my favorite television programs of all time. Certainly shows the protagonist Walter White and Jesse Pinkman rising above the madness, because they're just absolute, you know, mad capitalists. And they were just like, fuck it, we're going to take it upon ourselves. And it was a brilliant fucking show. But, you know, it just underscores all of the maladies of our society when something like that's, you know, going to happen. Why did Walter White become the, you know, the crack chemist? Well, because he lost his income and he couldn't afford his cancer, you know, procedure. So it was to save his life and his family, which of course, you know, leads to all sorts of insane things. And, you know, one I just recently watched that I thought was just impeccable as well, and actually created by a mainstream executive producer who's been around forever, a guy by the name of David Kelly, created the series Law and Order and many other things that showed up on network television over the course of the last two decades. And by the way, did he do the one with in Baltimore, The Wire also? Was he involved with it? I'm not sure. But anyway, that was a magnificent feature. I'm not sure if he was an executive producer on that. But I can tell you that they did a show that I just binge watched on Netflix called The Lincoln Lawyer. And what's The Lincoln Lawyer all about? Watch it. Pay close attention to the final episode. What's all this have to do with the con? Well, I revealed the real story. The real story that nobody in power wants you to understand. And I sacrificed my life to do it. And, you know, the pain and suffering that I've gone through on a personal basis is more than I ever could have imagined. But at the same time, it's nothing compared to what other people have experienced, to be quite honest with you. And so I've gone the distance, and I'm going to continue to go the distance. And, you know, things are happening one step at a time. Maybe I'm just, you know, optimistic giving these conversations that I've had today. But we don't have a choice in the duopoly. It's the new aristocracy in both forms, whether it's the new robber barons or the new confederacy. Out of those two choices, there's no non-choices. The choice is the integrity of law and liberty and justice for all. And these can't be platitudes. They can't be hollow words without a mission, without real substance. And, you know, to all of you who've shared yesterday during Memorial Day and over the weekend, your faux patriotism through, you know, this salute to people that, had, you know, maybe your family too. And I think you really believe that what you're saying is real. But, you know, when you're talking about your granddad who served in World War II and maybe landed in Normandy, which is a fantastic story, what are you going to do now? You're going to live vicariously through his commitment and his sacrifice? Where's yours? I know where mine is. Mine is what I've been doing every single day when I truth bomb the con, the largest criminal conspiracy and cover up in history that never ended, which is our system. We're better than corruption. The United States of America cannot yield to corruption any longer. The peaceful way that we can wrest control of the system is if everybody gets hip to the game, everybody gets the facts in the con, everybody comes together in this movement that I'm moving forward, you know, that I'm putting under the banner of the righteous grind, hashtag the righteous grind, hashtag failure is not an option, hashtag truth is marching, in context of hashtag the con, and then ultimately it winds up in hashtag the justice party, because the justice party is a political answer. I've got to get on the road to get these presentations to people that I'm going to call revivals, that I've got to educate people on the real facts of what I can demonstrate, which is a $50 trillion theft that went to the greedy tyrants that destroyed this. And if you think that the United States was built to serve tyrants and, you know, slave owners, I'm sorry, you don't understand what the fuck the United States is supposed to be about. And I refuse to allow that. And I know there's millions of you out there who would be right by my side, side by side, ready to storm the castle and make sure that we purge corruption. I know the cliche and the metaphors and everything sound like revolution. I am not saying that. If you see the con, the revolution is in the system doing the investigation to purge itself. If you watch The Lincoln Lawyer, you know, the final episode, I believe it's episode 10, You'll see how that plays out in fiction in a much smaller way. What I'm talking about is the Grand Symphony, the biggest story in the history of our lives. And if we don't get a hold of this, it will destroy us. It already has. It's destroyed millions of people already. Enough. It's got to end. We can do this. Onwards and upwards.